lo io non puro, stamattina mi ha scettato solo, adoro lo caffè, un stereo per canzone.
You know, it's a good Tuesday after Italy wins here on the Calcio Guys with Adriano DiNardo, Gianni Della Colli, and myself, Nicholas Di Giovanni. So we always come here every week talking about our own teams. You know, Adriano as a Milan fan, Gianni as the fake Napoli and fake Roma fan.
Wow, shots fired.
Me as the
Nicholas as the fake soccer fan, being a Juve supporter. So I mean,
I guess we'll put it that way.
Yeah.
And then I guess we could come in this week and be happy for once.
Yep.
Yeah.
Huge win by Italy.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, big enough, right? I mean,
it was expected. If they didn't win this game, or if they got a draw from this result, and if they get a draw today, either one, it's a disappointment. And this is the game that we have to look back to if we have trouble qualifying for Euros, because these are the games that are guaranteed wins, and we have to take them.
Yeah, no, especially at home, it was crucial. I think me and Nicholas said it before the the international break started. These are games at home. You have to finish. You have to produce. And you know what? We saw a different Italy, I think, this time around, scoring early too. So you know what? I'm pretty happy today.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, no, for sure.
This is what the game. This is at least what the goal sounded like.
In the midfield, it's been fired in its way by the skipper, Parr, and then the shot, deflection. And the goalkeeper stood no chance. Not a fool who got up and struck that ball with some venom. To him, he slipped it through towards Moise Kean. Big run, super goal. That's his first international goal.
So Nicolò Barella and Moise Kean get the goals for Italy. Mm-hmm. Some young players are scoring now for the Italian team. 12 different goal scorers the past 12 goals, or is it 14, Adriano? You know the stat.
Is it 14?
14 or 12, I forget.
It might be 14. Is it? To be honest,
it's 12. Sure. It's 12.
It's 12?
Yeah.
Is it? Okay.
And so, what did you guys see from the game?
I mean, I said it before. I think I saw a bit of a different Italy. I saw them, attacking for once. So we've been discussing with on the show about Italy's attack problem, and it's been a problem for a long time now. And you know what? We gotta go early. So for me, that was a big positive, because I don't think we've seen an early goal and Italy, I guess, taking control early in quite a while. So for me, I was pretty happy for that. I also liked that, as you said before, the young guys got in there. We've been stressing this ever since we didn't qualify for the World Cup this summer. We need to change the old mentality, bring in these younger kids, get them going, getting these experiences. And I think Mancini is doing a good enough job doing that. And he rolled the dice with some young guys against Finland, and it paid off for him.
It was definitely an aggressive side from Italy, for sure. I mean, I just have some quick stats here. They took 11 shots. Only 3 were on target, because a lot of them were very impatient shots. But and 5 offsides, even though it's a silly stat, it tells a story of how they were aggressive with the ball. They tried to get in there as much as they could. They tried to break through the 5-man back of Finland.
Yeah.
And I mean, the inexperience showed. A lot of the players were making silly mistakes. A lot of missed passes. A lot of terrible passes. Immobile couldn't get anything. Mm. So that's the only downside to it. And we also have to look at the story, though, is that, yeah, we won the game, but there was a lot of opportunities where Finland could have, that was that really scary opportunity that they just missed the net by a bit. And there was the other opportunity where Donnarumma had the ball slip from his hands. And it's a win. Great. We're happy. We'll take the result. But yeah, there's a lot of work to be done.
Yeah.
You know what I like? I like the midfield right now.
Yes.
I think it's a really well-balanced midfield between Barella, Jorginho, and Verratti. And you saw that again on Saturday.
Yeah.
You know, they were controlling the game. And, it's 3 guys with 3 different playing styles, I find. And Barella, I like that he scored, because he said it in one of the press conferences earlier in the week. He said, I need to score more. And he does exactly what he says.
And even if it wasn't deflected off the defenseman, that was a nice cannon of a shot.
Yeah, it was a strong shot.
Yeah, it had a lot of power behind it. Off the volley, too.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, I know, for sure.
Moise Kean, he's just been fantastic. He's just come into 2019 and taken control.
Remember when I said it when we first started this show, like maybe the national team should start playing to kids like Kean, Koutras, just like in friendly games, just to see what they can do.
Yeah.
And it's showing. I mean, like, these kids are eager to take over the spots of other people that have it. You know, now, like, for example, if Keane's going to play on the left side, he's going to compete with not only El Shaarawy, but also Insigne. So he's got to demonstrate why he deserves the spot over those two. And Insigne and El Shaarawy are two of my favorite players. So, I mean, it's nice to see that Italy on the wing especially the wings, the left wing and the right wing, are embarrassed with talent. Like, it's so crazy. And now we have a third option to use. So they can have a option A, option B, option C. And I'm really happy what Kean did. There was the only thing I just really didn't like about Moise Kean in this game was that he was just a little bit too all over the place. Like, he didn't really stay in his territory. There was times where he was in the middle of the box and all of a sudden he's on the right side. There's nothing wrong with it. Like, it's just like he wants to get so involved, but don't worry, the ball's going to get there. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I think it's because he's not an out striker, right? And he was pointing out on the wings. Mancini put him on the wings. I think it was Mancini actually that switched him over on each side, on the left and the right. I'm not 100% sure, but I'm pretty sure that's what I had seen. More Mancini doing it than him doing it on his own. So I think he just, you know, he wants the ball. He wants to score. He's hungry. He's explosive. So, I mean, these types of players, and they're young, you know, they want those opportunities, as many opportunities as they can get. I do agree. Maybe, you stick to your position and, you know, things will come. But if you can create as an attacker, instead of just waiting for service, I think that's an added bonus.
You know what I find Kean is doing a really good job at? Johnny brought it up. You said he was out of position, but I find he's in the good position at the perfect time. And that's how he's scoring his goals, whether it be for Juve or this goal for Italy. You know, he is going to make errors. He is 19 years old.
Yeah, it's understandable.
Yeah, he is going to make errors and he is going to be all over the place. But what counts is that he's in the right time at the right place. And he's that clinical finisher. And that was a nice finish.
No, it was. That was a nice through ball by Immobile, too. Yeah, like, it was perfectly placed.
Yeah, I would agree. I mean, Immobile wasn't having the greatest games, but
he never does with the national team.
It's crazy. I don't know what goes through in this guy's head, but you know what? He put a good ball in, and I'm surprised he put that ball in, to be honest with you. But Kean made a good run as well, and he finished it and put us 2-0 up. So I think we can all be happy about that.
There were a few more chances that I think Immobile should have done better. Same with Bernadeschi, just a bit.
Yeah, Bernadeschi.
I was going to say.
Yeah, he disappointed me just a bit. I like
the start.
Yeah,
no, that start. He came out. They almost scored like in the opening 10 seconds.
His start and his ending was great.
It was a tale.
But in between,
there's 89 minutes in the middle.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's like that's the thing. Like we've seen better from Bernadeschi. We haven't like
in recent probably, times too.
Yeah, it's not his. This game wasn't his best game, but we've seen great games from him. But he had like these phantom passes that were just like to no man's land. Yeah. You know, there was nobody there. Why is he putting he's trying to create something, but he's trying too hard. And then there's some of these shots that were just released a little too early. You know, like I remember like the game. Which game was it? Where they? I think it was the Poland game, for example, where they played. What was it? It was they played with the false nine. It was Bernadeschi and Insigne and
Chiesa.
And we saw Bernadeschi always being aggressive and taking those shots, and a lot of them went wide. Or I feel like he's just a bit too trigger happy for me.
But
for me, like but we can look past that. It was just the one thing I couldn't look past at this game was those like phantom passes to no man's land where there was nobody there.
Yeah, I would absolutely agree. I mean, we saw him, as I said in recent times, that he's been you know good. He's been creating, but I think he's more of a creative player than an out and out finisher for me personally. So if he can stick to that and stick to that number 10 role, I think he'll be good.
So usually we have 10 games to talk about on the Calcio guys, but we're gonna continue sticking with this one game. And we're going to preview Italy versus Liechtenstein next on the Calcio Guys on CGO 1690. Welcome back to the Calcio Guys with Adriano DiNardo, Gianni Del Colli. I'm Nicholas Di Giovanni. We're going to have Alex Koutras join us in studio in about 15 minutes. Yeah. Rare that we actually have an in-studio guest.
Yeah.
And so, looking at this Italy team, you know, Italy-Liechtenstein today, they just beat Finland 2-0. Fabio Quagliarella, he might start today. Well, according to our expert over here, Adriano, our social media expert.
Yeah.
He might get the start as striker.
Yeah.
And he played about, 10 minutes against Finland? And he had more chances than in 80 minutes than Immobile?
Oh, for sure. Like, it was remarkable. I mean, what a story that would have been if he would have came on. His first touch would have been in the back of the net. I think all of Italy would have been going crazy. We would have been pretty going crazy as well.
Grown men would have been brought to tears.
No, but seriously, we say it again, 36 years old. He's back in the national team after, 9, 10 years, whatever the number is. He comes in the 80th minute for Immobile. Was it for Immobile? No. I don't remember who he came on.
Yeah, for Immobile.
Was it straight for Immobile?
Yeah. Thanks, yeah. Alex, to Alex Koutras for that.
It was straight for Immobile. And at the 80th minute. And he made an instant impact. That first cross, I think it was by Bernardeschi, got right on the head of Quags, and he almost put it in the back of the net.
It was that one, like I said, that towards the ending, the Bernardeschi was getting better.
Again, yeah.
And that was the pass that actually looked good.
Exactly. And they got him right on the head, and he almost put it back. And then he ringed one off the crossbar, and that was another great opportunity. He had two shots. I guess that's one on target as well. But I mean, for Quagliarella, we hope he starts today. We hope that he can produce, and we hope that he can score like he's been doing in Italy.
I hate to be that guy, but actually I like Quagliarella as a super sub rather than an actual starter.
I can see that.
Don't be that guy.
No, I'm going to be that guy because he might not have obviously he plays full matches with Sampdoria, but
yeah.
It's so deadly that defenders have to, let's say, handle Immobile, and then you have the fast wingers, right? And all of a sudden now when Immobile gets swept off, you got Quagliarella who's just ready to come in and dominate. It's an extra push, and that's something that he can capitalize on their mistakes, and he's a smart player, so he knows how to make them pay for their mistakes. It's like I guess the easiest comparison, the easiest thing to look at is when Hal Del Piero was used in the 06 World Cup. He was used as a super sub, and yeah. He came on and he had those dominant games because he was using towards the latter half of the game. I think the same thing should be used with Quags. That's just my personal opinion there. I don't think he should really be starting, but it's not a bad idea if he starts. I won't be mad.
Yeah.
I'm just saying I think he's best used as a super sub rather than a starter.
That's fair.
So before we go through the probable starting lineup,
yeah.
I want to ask you guys. So we had to watch this game on streaming because for this tournament, for this qualifying, there's no qualifiers on TV between TSN, Sportsnet, DAZN. You can't watch it on TV in Canada. Okay. I have a problem with this because, Canada is hosting the World Cup in 7 years. Yet, we still can't watch high-level European soccer. You're able to watch Canada versus French Guinea in CONCACAF Nations League. Who wants to watch that? All due respect to Canada. Alex, watch that. If you like the Canadian national team, that's good. But it's not good soccer.
Yeah.
I'd rather watch European soccer.
It's not the highest quality, obviously, but you still got to watch your boys.
Yeah, no. For sure. It's a good thing that was on TV. But I'd rather see European qualifiers. And it's just frustrating for us fans because TSN and Sportsnet, even DAZN, they have this opportunity to market to a fan base that's going to watch their games in 2026 when the World Cup is on. And it's just I'd rather not go to bad streaming. I did watch it.
But the company that owns the rights don't give a crap about the people where they live. All the companies care about that own the rights is how much money they can make.
That's UEFA.
They just want to know. Yeah, they just want to know what gives us the most money, and we'll go with that.
And that's I think the problem right there.
And
yeah,
they don't see for them it's just a figure in front. It's not about the people behind it.
I'd rather just see it on DAZN because DAZN has Champions League, has Serie A, La Liga, and it's gonna have Premier League next year.
Yeah,
just give it to DAZN.
Yeah, I mean I agree with you 100%. I mean here in North America we've been struggling with this, with watching games. I mean, if you're not watching the Serie A on Rai or TLN, you have to now, thank God for DAZN that came out and they have this service that, shows these games. Same thing for international play. I mean, we have to really go diving into the internet to find these streams. If they're not in English, they're in Russian, they're in Spanish, they're in Arab, who knows what they're going to be in. But It just frustrating. I do agree with Nicholas 100%. It is frustrating because you want to be able to have that access. And I think there is potential. There is potential in other parts of the world. And I think Serie A, and I don't know if UEFA or whoever, whatever, they don't see that potential. Like Jenny said, they see that number in front of them, and that's what matters. Yes, that's making a lot of money. I understand that. But there is potential to grow, and there is fans in other parts of the world than where they're already stationed. So I think it should definitely be grown and spread across the world a bit more.
By the way, I actually looked it up, at least on Wikipedia.
Yeah.
There's no TV rights in English for Euro 2020 yet for Canada. TVA signed a contract. So worst case scenario, we're going to have to watch it in French.
No, I'm going to put it on mute. I can't watch it in French.
Bernardeschi!
Bernardeschi avec le but! Quel but de Bernardeschi!
I can't. I'm going to put it on mute, I swear.
But I hope UEFA comes to an agreement, at least with TSN, Sportsnet, or DAZN for Euro 2020.
Yeah.
Looking ahead today, Liechtenstein, we're going to have to watch it on streaming again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Probable lineup? Yeah, take it away, Adriano.
Yeah, so the probable lineup that we saw this morning. So they're going with a bit of changes in the lineup that we saw against Finland today. So what it's going with a they're going with a 4-3-3. Mancini's going with a 4-3-3. Sidigu in net, Spinazzola on the left. The defense is going to be with Romagnoli and Bonucci and Gianluca Mancini on at the right back. A bit of a strange one, but he's out there. In the midfield, it's going to be Verratti, Jorginho, and Sensi. And in the attack, it's going to be Kean again on the left, Quagliarella, as we said, up top, and Politano on the right-hand side. So this is only probable. The game's at 3:45, so I guess we'll still have to wait and see if that's going to, you know, be the lineup. But I don't know. What do you think about this lineup?
Well, you first or me first?
Go first.
All right. Well, for me, I figured it's Liechtenstein. They only played two games versus them in their history, and they've won 4-0, 5-0 respectively. So yeah. I figured, okay, there's no stress on them being a threat offensively, so you could sacrifice a few guys in the back to put up guys up front to cushion the goal differential, because in case you need that goal differential to be the difference maker for first place or second place, yeah. This is the game to do so. So I figured maybe I agreed with the City Group part, but I actually went with a 3-1-2-1-3.
This is your preferred lineup?
This is my preferred, what I would prefer.
Okay.
And I think maybe this might be the option, but he might go in again with the 4-3-3.
Yeah.
But like my prediction was probably play Romagnoli with Chiellini and Bonucci in the back as your three center backs.
Okay.
I mixed up here. I put Verratti as center defensive mid and Jorginho as the right mid, Barella as the left mid, and Zaniolo as your center attacking mid.
Yeah.
Give him a shot, give him an opportunity to play a bit of a 70-minute game. And then the standard three from the strikers from the Finland game as Kean, Immobile, and Bernadeschi.
Hold up your paper. Hold up. So you got the full design out there.
Yeah.
That's good. I don't mind the lineup. I like the midfield again, just replacing Sensi for Barella. I want to see what Sensi could do because he's played really well with Sassuolo this season.
I wouldn't be surprised if a player like Grifo even gets a shot like for 10 minutes.
Yeah, just to see. Near the end.
It's also tough. I don't mind the lineup either. I like that Romagnoli is in there. I think he deserves a shot.
Definitely does.
Yeah, Mancini too. I mean, him and Itzo, we were saying before the lineup or the call-up team got started, when me and Nick had predicted who would be, you know, on the team, we both thought that Mancini and Itzo should get a shot. And I'm glad that, you know, Mancini is getting that shot. I know it's at right back, maybe not his preferred position, but I like him out there. Also, I mean, there's been guys, we've been dropping that like flies. I don't know if you guys saw, El Shaarawy had to go home. Florenzi, Chiesa. So, I mean, these are guys, Insigne wasn't even there, yeah. Right? So these are guys that could be starters. I would have liked to see El Shaarawy in there, but I mean, they're still going with that Kean, Quagliarella, and now Politano up front. So, I mean, I would probably give this lineup, I don't know, an average grade, I guess.
You know what I see with Mancini right back?
What?
You could change this formation into a 3-5-2. Your three center backs, Romagnoli, Bonucci, Mancini.
Yeah.
You have a midfield of Ratti, Jorginho, Sensi.
Yeah.
Your outside wingers are Politano and Spinazzola. And then you have Kean and Quagliarella as striker.
It could be. I mean, it depends how the game goes. That's very well said. I mean, that is a possibility. Maybe is that what he's thinking, Mancini, in the back of his mind? You never know. I could definitely see that because it does work. But I don't know. For me personally, I would stick with the four back. I don't know. Johnny seems to disagree, but
I would
go with the four back. What do you have to say, Johnny?
See, the thing is, though, like it's a blessing and a curse that we have so many different combinations that are possible and so many opportunities. But the thing is, they need to figure out something as soon as possible because they need to get these guys cemented together and kind of formed into a formation that they're all going to be great with.
I agree.
And even though they're very talented soccer players and they could themselves technically could play in almost any position or any formation because they just know how to adjust, it's still nice to get that chemistry developed and solidified right before the major tournament. And
well, there's still a year and a half.
There's still a year and change. Yeah, but yeah. The thing is,
but there's important games coming up, like that Greece game, the Bosnia game. I mean, those
the two games in June are the biggest ones.
Those games are not going to be maybe like this Finland and Liechtenstein game. So I think I agree 100% with Johnny. They should really get a lineup out there that and chemistry going because it's going to serve them, you know, a lot in the future. I think.
I think some of these guys, so it's obviously still only three subs, but I don't see Kean playing more than 60 minutes, considering he played 90 against Finland.
The kid's 19. He can do it.
I think he can do it too. No, but
the kid's 19, doesn't get any play. He can't play out he that only gets much. Like, what, one or two games a year at Juve? I mean, like, come on, why not?
I would play him out.
Quagliarella, he could probably play 70 to 75, depending how he's playing. Yeah. I think he's going to score tonight. I mean, it is Liechtenstein. All due respect to them.
Let's hope. Yeah.
But, they're not. They can't even hold up a candle at dinner with Italy, right? I mean, like, it's just.
It was 5-0 2 years ago?
Yeah, and it was 4-0 the game before. That's the thing. Like,
I think Kandreva scored against Liechtenstein. So if you know Kandreva scores.
Yeah. But okay, Kandreva 3 years ago was really good.
I don't know, when he was still with Lazio.
Yeah, and then he went to, was it Inter now? Yeah. And then everybody forgot about
him. Yeah, it's because he's a snake, that's why.
City go Nets, he deserves that.
Yeah.
We talked about it about 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
In terms of who's going to be a starting goalies, makes sense. Donnarumma one game, City go the other. Mm-hmm. City go, he probably won't have to face that much work.
Nope.
So, not a night off for him.
Probably,
but
probably get like a shot or two.
Yeah.
Still got to be careful about that.
A few goal kicks.
Yeah. Work out those legs.
Any predictions from you guys?
I mean, if they don't hammer them, I mean, it's another step back for me personally. Seeing that we had a good performance against Finland, I think it wasn't maybe the best performance, but it was a good performance. So I don't know. I would probably say, I'll say 3-0. I'll say 3-0.
I'm actually very comfortable with that. I was thinking at a 3-0 win for Italy, not going to be a dominant offensive performance, but still. Still a victory nonetheless. So 3-0 for me as well.
I say 4-0. You think if Italy concedes, that's a big problem?
It's not a problem.
Alex says yes.
Alex says yes. I mean, yes and no. I mean, yeah, for I guess like the you know, the stats and all that, but and going on to these next games come the next international break. But I mean, they're going with a different defensive line. So, I mean, it might happen, but at the same time, I wouldn't put too much stress on that. As long as you can continue scoring those goals, I mean, it kind of bounces out on the other end. So, for me, it's not the biggest worry in the world, but I would like to see the clean sheet, obviously.
So, we're going to head to break. On the other side of break, we're going to have Alex Koutras join us, talk about everything about Italian soccer, Greek soccer, MLS, just a whole soccer
talk. The whole nine today.
Going a bit different today here on the Calcio Guys on CJO 1690. It's not something you hear too often when you talk about Italian soccer. That's the Greek national anthem. That's because we have Alex Koutras joining us. Alex.
Alexander Koutras to you.
Alexander, how's it going?
If my father heard you, he'd be a little upset.
How's it going?
Not bad, not bad. Buongiorno a tutti. How's everybody doing today?
Not too bad. So, tell us a bit about yourself in terms of like soccer fandom. So you're half Greek, half Italian.
Yes, that is correct. I'm half Greek, half Italian.
Which national side do you cheer for more?
Oh, I just hope that they've never played each other as long as I've been alive. So this is a first for me. This is really a first for me, really.
So 2004 to 2006 was, your peak.
Yeah, it was your peak.
those were the best of times. Those were the good of times.
Yeah, the golden years.
The golden years. Yeah, no, for sure. Those were the golden years, guys. But that 2004 run was... people don't really remember that. You know, they finished first in their qualifying group. You know, they beat Spain in qualifying. And they're all surprised when they made it.
Yeah. I mean, they didn't qualify for the World Cup after.
No, they didn't. But I mean, that's what happens when your players get old.
Yeah.
You keep the same squad. You keep the same tactics. Eventually, people will catch on.
Yeah.
You can't play five at the back forever.
So in terms of clubs, who do you support?
Well, growing up, I watched. Listen, my grandparents are from a little town called Puente Gandolfo in Benevento. But it's you're a stone's throw from Naples, basically. So you're watching Napoli. My grandfather, unfortunately, he's a big Juventus fan. Holy crap. And that's sinful. You can't support Juve and support Napoli. Yeah.
No.
Because, you know, it's the north and the south.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I, unfortunately, I live in sin because I love both of them.
Oh, my God.
You know, I love... And when they play, I just hope they tie or maybe a rain delay or something.
Wow.
You know, my nonna still says Juve merda whenever they watch the game. And my nonna still looks at my grandfather with like this, just, you know, that eye of like, oh, you support the other team.
Interesting.
For sure, man.
So, I mean, besides, like, what caught your eye about, or how long ago did you start this, I guess, soccer fandom or cultural fandom? When did you start supporting Juve? Seeing that, obviously, you said, you know, Napoli, I guess, is in the blood, but Juve, why Juve?
Just my nonna supported them.
That's basically
my nonna supported him, and whenever we watched the games, it was just, that's the team you got to root for. You know, when you grow up watching, you know, all the, you know, all the older players play. When you grow up watching games with your grandfather, with your family, it's just, you feel special. You feel something close. And even though it's, you know, the North and the South, you still find appreciation for the two of them.
Hey, Koutras, big fan.
Hi, Johnny.
Oh, hi there. So we were talking a lot about the national team.
Yes, we were.
And
I heard a lot.
Yes, and I know that you and I, on the way here, we had a discussion about it, but yes, I want you to share your, like, let's say your
also,
probable.
Also, if the mayor is listening, please fix the roads,
please. Madame Plante, she definitely listens to the cultural guys.
Seal of approval right
Seal
there.
Of approval.
So what was, like your probable lineup for this upcoming game today, and what did you also like and dislike about the game versus Finland?
The game versus Finland was I think they shouldn't have taken Bonucci for these two games because he still looked a bit rough at the back. He was injured when, like 2 months ago? And I don't think he's fully recovered. I think we should have rested Bonucci, maybe taken Rugani or taken Tonelli from Napoli.
Yeah.
You know, just to give the guys a rest because there were a few moments where, you know, those Finnish strikers and those attacking mid, well, that one, did they play two at the front, I think, or one at the front?
I think they played a 4-2-2.
No, they played five at the
five,
back.
Five,
but
four,
then,
four,
that,
two.
They got, I think, with two or three shots where, you know, the ball, the ball went wide. But, like, if it was any other team, they would have gladly taken that opportunity to score. I mean, Italy themselves missed, you know, they won 2-0, but, I mean, could have easily been, like, 4 or 5-0.
So, by the way, the lineup just came out for today's game.
Oh, really?
Exactly, yeah. Like we predicted.
4-3-3?
Yeah.
Okay.
What do you like about that lineup?
Is it exactly like we predicted?
Yeah.
Oh, this thing is great. Quag's at the front?
Yeah.
Napolitan himself?
You're taking one Napolitan striker for another.
Yeah, basically did. I mean, I like it. I like that what we predicted was pretty much good, was right. And I think it's good. It's a good front to play Liechtenstein. We can't go wrong. Now, for the rest of the qualifications, we're gonna have to, you know, trim the fat, so to speak.
Interesting.
We're gonna have to, because listen, look who's on our squad. Look who we brought with us. Okay, just to give you an idea, we brought. I got the notes here.
Okay. Pen and paper, I love
pen
it.
And, if you have no idea, okay.
See, I'm not the only one anymore.
We brought Pavoletti. Okay, guys.
Yeah.
Why do we bring Pavoletti?
Because he scores goals.
For me, it's more lasagna, but
That's another thing, lasagna. Why? I mean, I understand. I mean, I've been a fan for lasagna ever since he was at Capri.
I've been a fan of lasagna ever since I was a kid. Another form of lasagna.
Well, you know what I'm saying? Like, listen, we have guys like Roberto Inglese, who plays for Parma, who's a loanee from Napoli.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, he's got 8 goals so far this season. So far. He's got one more than Dzeko. 3 more goals than lasagna. All right? Inglese scores every 2.68 games. All right? Lasagna scores every 3.79 games. Now, what are you going to say? That they one plays more minutes than the other? It's only 200 minutes difference between the two of them. You know, same thing with Pavoletti. Pavoletti is actually, he averages more fouls per game than anybody in Serie A. Down the line, when is that? That's going to hurt us.
And that's a striker. He should not
be taking fouls.
I wonder if, I don't know if you have these stats, but I wonder who leads the league in offsides. Because if I'd put money on that, it'd definitely be Immobile.
This guy can't stay onside.
Immobile, I didn't write it down. I didn't write it down, but he's on the top five. He's in the top five.
For sure.
He's in the top for sure. And here's another person that we could actually use. Ever hear of Francesco Caputo?
Yeah.
Chicho!
We like him here.
Guy's got 13 goals.
Yeah.
He can assist as well, guys. Okay? Scores 100. He scores every 194 minutes. That's every 2 games almost. And he plays for Empoli. And he's 31 years old. Guys, Belotti. Who loves Belotti here?
We have mixed emotions, I think.
Mixed emotions?
Yeah. I used to be big on Belotti, but...
Yeah, when he scored, what, 25 goals in that season?
Yeah, exactly. And then the season afterwards, he only had, like...
And then he got a pay raise, and then he did nothing.
Yeah, exactly. And that's why I've been kind of frustrated with him.
Belotti, guys, has 10 goals so far.
Yeah, but I think like 3 or 4 of them are penalties.
Exactly.
Yeah, okay. Then if you're going to use that argument, Quagliarella shouldn't be on the team. Because
he's got a point.
He's got a point. But listen, Belotti scores every 249 minutes. That's almost 3 games. That's 2 and 3 quarters of a game.
What about Balotelli?
Pavoletti. Okay, same thing. Almost. Listen. About who?
Balotelli. What about Balotelli?
Balotelli hasn't. Listen, he Balotelli
because
he can't work with coaches.
He can't work with coaches.
He cannot work with coaches.
But I think he could work with Mancini.
Well, remember when was it?
Man City.
No, was it Man City? Yeah, it was Man City. They were at each other's throats. Just because you're Italian doesn't mean you like each other because you're Italian.
No, but right? I think at that time he was a big father figure for Balotelli, and I think he worked him good. I mean, Balotelli is always going to have that character, I think, so that's not going to change. It's going to be the constant there. But personally, most of us here thought that Balotelli should have been on the lineup.
When does the qualification end? Like, when is the last day of qualifications?
In total, for the Euros, it's next November.
Next November?
Yeah.
He has the rest of the season to prove himself.
Yeah.
All right, he's at Marseille now. Yeah. He left. Nice. He left Nice, so he left. Mind you, when he was at Nice, when to start off, he was doing pretty well. And I thought that he was, you know, quote unquote cured from his attitude issues.
Yeah,
but it slowly came back. Now he's at Marseille. It's a bigger market in the French and in Ligue 1. So far, he's doing pretty good. He scored, I think, 3 goals so far since the transfer window.
I think he has like 6 and 7. No,
doesn't he have something
six
like that?
6 goals in 7 games or something like that.
Now, he's got the rest of the season to score some goals. Yeah. Show to Mancini that he can score goals. Because, yes, we do need goals to be scored. Because right now, listen, we're in a group where Italy is considered the favorites, even though we didn't make the World Cup. He's got 5 goals in 8 games. 5 goals in 8 games. All right, my bad. So he's got, yeah, no, for sure, that's good. yeah, but listen, we're in a group where they're the favorites, even though they didn't make the World Cup last year, last World Cup.
Me. I dropped my phone.
Now, who else is in the group? We have Bosnia.
Yeah, Bosnia, Greece.
How about Greece? Oh, are you looking forward to that?
You're Greece.
Oh, yeah. Am I looking forward to Greece and Italy?
Yeah.
No.
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 Another rain delay, right?
Another rain delay, I hope, or snow delay. Or listen, what I listen, they have to be careful because, yes, they're playing teams that are like Liechtenstein and Finland and Armenia that should be easy victories.
Yeah, quote unquote.
Quote unquote easy victories. Now, when they play teams like Bosnia and when they play teams like Greece, they have to be on the level. They have to bring in their A game. They have to bring in their Ruganis. Florenzi has to be healthy because he's the right back, but he also comes up. Okay. Insigne has to be healthy. He's got to be there. And they got to take advantage of their chances because that's what's going to bite us in the end.
I agree 100%.
Chiellini.
Chances, yeah.
Chiellini and Bonucci, I love them. But their legs are eventually going to give out. And then what? We saw a glimpse of Bonucci's legs giving out against Finland. A glimpse. And it almost costed them a goal. Now, Bonucci is playing today. Yeah. Now, I would have rested him.
So, bringing up that point, then what would you suggest if you're let's play armchair GM for a bit, right? So obviously Romagnoli is the number one choice, but who else would you put there to replace Chiellini and Bonucci?
I would have put Tonelli. I would have brought Tonelli on the squad and I would put him.
But who we have like?
Oh, who we have right now?
In the call ups, like who would you? Put instead? But Tonelli, I like that choice. If you would have to say next to partnering with Romagnoli.
Itso is a center back?
Yes.
Oh, I would have played Itso.
Did he get called up? Yeah.
Yeah, huh? He did.
Yeah, he did.
And that's another person that I would Itso because he's on fire this season. He's got four goals so far for Torino. I think he's got the most, he's up there with the most goals for defenders.
I think so, yes.
All right. His tackles per game is high. Okay. So he's not afraid to go for the ball, whether it's defensive or offensive. And Itso is 27 years old. So he's in his prime. Like, for the next 3 years, it's his prime. We need to capitalize on it. The Italian national team has to capitalize on these players. We do have a good mix of youth and older players. But we need to capitalize on them. That's the problem they have. They don't know how to capitalize.
Barring any injuries.
Yes.
Because right now, like, you would think at least a right back?
Yes.
Florenzi is in his prime. He's hurt right now. That's why
Mancini's playing. Pacini, he did really good.
I was going to say that.
Yeah, you like that?
No, for sure, man. No.
As a player, we don't talk about because he plays in Spain.
He plays in Valencia.
Yeah. Same thing with Grifo. Grifo. A lot of people are going to rip on Grifo, but he plays in Germany. We don't know enough about him.
Yeah, we don't watch enough to know.
I understand why they brought Grifo.
Why? Why do you think?
Because they want to see him. It's 2 games against Liechtenstein and Finland. We want to see how they want to, you know, work him out with the rest of the team, see how he is. They're not going to play him.
Yeah, at least in training.
But they want to train with him, see what he looks like.
Interesting.
But in the long run, I don't think he'll make like more than like 5 caps in his career. not to be rude. Also, just for schnitz and giggles, I have my third place, choice goalkeeper already set up, because that is the most important position.
I know that each round you like that.
Okay.
Yeah, I think this guy watched last week.
No, I missed last week. Okay. I want Sorrentino to be my third choice goalkeeper.
Hey, Stefano.
At 40 years old.
You want to know why? He's your third choice. He's not going to play.
Yeah.
But he'll bring the locker room together. And that's what you need to win a tournament, to win a championship, and to win the hearts.
That's all right.
He's been with Kiev for how many years? How many relegations has he been through? How many promotions?
They always avoid relegation, Kiev.
Right. Right.
And he's with Palermo too.
Yeah, there we go. Oh, it's true.
Palermo too.
Oh my God, I forgot about that. He was with Palermo too.
Yeah.
And he was relegated with Palermo, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, possibly.
So that's the thing. You want somebody. He's going to be your... Buffon's not coming back.
No, he's done.
Okay? But
Sorrentino, he's always played for such bad teams and he's always done a good job.
You know, he's always done the best he could. Okay? Here's another player. Andrea Petagna. Does anybody ring any bells for you?
Yeah, Petagna.
Okay, plays for Spal. He's on loan.
Spal.
Spak. He's on loan from Atalanta. This guy's been on loan his entire career. Okay, he came from the Milan Academy. Okay, played 3 games for them, and that's it. Then he went on loan to Sampdoria, played another 3 games there. Went to Latina. What did I say? Right? Yeah, Latina. I think it's Serie B or Serie C team. Vicenza. Then he went to Ascoli. And now then he went to Atalanta. Played 1 season in Atlanta, Atlanta shipped him out. Scored 6 goals, I think, last season for them, or 5 goals, or I'm not quite 100% sure. And then they shipped him out on loan today. Now he's got 11 goals. He's 6'3". He's a target, man.
Yeah, he could probably do a good job.
And
he's young, too.
He's
in his early 20s.
He's 22, I think. 23 years old. I have it right here. 23 years old.
Fun fact about Sorrentino, as I looked it up, he won Serie A in 1998 with Juve. he won a Scudetto with them. My God. You
know, does anybody know Manuel Lazzari?
Lazzari, yes.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
For Spal, too.
Yeah.
Okay. He is the second best in the league in crosses per game. He connects more crosses. He's the only he's the Italian that connects the most crosses per game in Italy, in Serie A.
And we probably need him right now at right back.
Yeah. Exactly. And put him with our old other friend from Spal. And there you go. You make connections. You got to make those connections. Remember when Team Canada won gold? All their
in what, 2010, 2014?
All their hockey lineups were like people playing the same division, people in the same team.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. 2010, you had the Sharks line,
the Sharks line, the Ducks line. That's what you need.
Yeah.
You need connections. You need connectivity, and you need heart. That's what you need.
So that will do it from us, or at least from Alexander.
Yeah, Koutras, thank you very much.
Here on the Calcio Guys, we're going
to also. I just want to say before Roma will finish 9th this season or 7th. Wow. That's what happens when you sign Ranieri.
You heard it here first.
Yes, you did.
Okay.
You heard
also,
it here
Sampdoria first. Is going to get that last Europa spot.
Oh. You heard it here first on the Calcio Guys. On the other side of the break, teeing up some big games, Serie A match day 29.
Big games, guys. Calcio
Guys.
Yeah, no, for sure, guys.
On CGO 6090.
Thank you.
Welcome back to the Calcio Guys on CGO 6090 with Gianni Del Colli, Gianno DiNardo, Nicholas DiGiovanni. So, Italy Liechtenstein coming up in about 55 minutes from now.
Yep.
Hey, Gianno, I was just looking at your Italy shirt. I was looking at my Italy shirt. If you guys had to do a quick ranking of Italy shirts in the past, I don't know, 20 years, 25 years?
Oh, okay. I've been waiting for this my whole life. Let's do this.
Let's go. Top 5.
Okay.
Before we get to Serie A match day 29.
Number 1, the 1998 Italy, the France 98 jersey. That was a very, very
good. You're going too far for us.
Well, yeah, because you guys were just born. The 98 jersey was just, it was so nice. It looked great. The 02 jersey would be my number 2 because of the stretch material. Well, forget about the tournament, but the jersey itself, the material was great. It's funny because you would watch players trying to, you see defenders trying to grab onto the strikers because, you know, everybody likes to grab or pull, but you see them, they're getting pulled by the player, like just to stretch. And sometimes it would rip, and that would showcase, like, look, hey, I just got pulled. You should give this guy a card. So that was a very strategic jersey. 06 would be my number 3. The Euro 08 jersey was really nice too. I like the trim. And,
man, I don't even know.
My fifth one, I think the Euro 02 jersey was also nice, but I think it's when they were starting to experiment with the gold trim. No, what am I saying? Euro 2000. I think it was Euro 2000. Anyways, but those, like, at least the first four stood up. It was 04? It was Euro 04-1. Thank you. Yeah, so yeah, it was Euro 04-1. They started to experiment with the gold and the blue together. So I think that's overall my top five jerseys.
You, Adriano?
Past 20 years.
I don't even know.
I know, putting you on the spot.
I mean, I don't know if I have a top five, but I mean, obviously, I think the 06 is closest to our hearts, at least, you know, for me, Nicholas, even Gianni too. He saw a bit more, obviously, than us, but 06, I mean, it was an iconic jersey, obviously, with the World Cup win. The jersey I'm wearing, I mean, I don't remember when this is from. What is it? 2014.
2014.
Yeah, Alex confirmed 2014. So, I mean, I honestly like this one a lot. I really do. The 0-2, like Johnny said as well, it looked clean in that tournament. Obviously, you know what? We know all what happened there. But the jersey, I think, was clean. We didn't touch upon this year's jersey or, you know, these past, year and a half or jersey, whatever.
Because there's no memories.
There's no memories yet, but... you know what? I actually don't mind it. At first, I wasn't a big fan, but it kind of grew a bit on me, and I would probably put that one. I don't think all time there, but in recent memory, I think that one is nice. I mean, I like it. I like how it's a bit more modern, and they're getting a bit with the times. Italy.
For me, I'd have to go 2014 number 5.
Okay,
it's a pretty nice jersey.
Yeah,
I'll go 2008, their white one. As a number 4 pick. I like their white jersey. Alex agrees with me. I like their white jersey. Number 3.
Oh, I had another one. The one with the, what was that? 2012 with the white collar and the Italian flag in there. Yeah. That one was actually pretty good too.
I was just about to think.
Is that 2012?
Yeah. No. Yeah. Yeah. Number 3 is that because of the collar.
Yeah.
Number 2, 02. I think that's top on a lot of people's list. And then number 1, obviously 06, just because of the memories.
Yeah. Honorable mention to the 06 away jersey where it was white, but it had like, it looked like as if you're wearing two shirts in one because the collar
it was underneath.
Yeah, because it was a white jersey, but like it was a V-neck cut, and underneath the V-neck cut was the blue with the emblem.
Yeah.
So
they brought that back. When did they bring that back?
Yeah, 2 years ago. 2 years ago. To mark like 10 years since World Cup win. Yeah. Okay, we digress.
Yes.
Back to Serie A Match Day 29. A lot of good games here.
Yeah.
Sampdoria, Milan, Parma, Atalanta, Fiorentina, Torino. And the two big ones, Roma, Napoli. Gianni, I know you'll be paying attention, then Inter Lazio. By the way, Europe pushes their clocks forward this weekend, so all the games on Sunday are back to normal time.
Technically.
Yeah, technically. So it's about time. Obviously, the big one is, I say, the Derby della Sole, Roma, Napoli. Johnny, any thoughts on that one?
I'm just going to say it's going to be a 3-1 Napoli win.
Again, I think you always say that.
Because right now Roma's a mess. They're this kind of disorganized. They're having a hard time figuring themselves out. Napoli, they're well-coached under Ancelotti, and they're the ones that are probably the best offensive team. And besides stats-wise, it doesn't show, but they could put on anybody at any time, and they're deadly up front. So... and plus, we've seen that Roma's back line has been very shaky, especially when a crucial player like Manolas isn't playing. Even though he's going to play, but I mean, like, you could see how Juan Jesus is. I don't want to keep on talking about Juan Jesus, but overall, I think Roma right now they're in a bit of a spiral. It's going to take some time for them to, unfortunately, as a fan to say that, it's going to take a couple of games or two to just for them to find their solid ground underneath them. And I think Napoli's going to capitalize on it.
I would agree. I mean, we've said it time and time again with this Roma team. It's a mess. You think Inter's bad with that soap opera? I mean, Roma's even, I'm almost equivalent to that. Their play has been shocking this season. I mean, it's not something that I guess we expect, I guess, from Roma, but it's been a mess from top to bottom, I would say. I would probably agree with Johnny that Napoli should take that game. I don't know if it's going to be easy, but I do think they'll take the game. Personally, I'm going to say the Milan-Samp game, I think it's a pretty good game. It's, you know, a bounce back game for Milan, obviously, coming out of the derby, coming out of this international break. You know, we've seen their players have been producing on the international stage. So, and Samp, I think, as Alex said, he thinks they're going to be in that last Europa spot. I could see that. I could definitely see that. We've seen Samp play as a team.
3 points behind.
Yeah, we've seen them play as a team. We've seen them play hard, and you know, they're a good team. So I could definitely see that. I think that's why I think it's gonna be a good game. The Lazio Inter game should be a good game too. I think it's another one again, middle of the pack race, Champions League.
Well, that's the most important standing wise, because Inter is at 53 points, third place, and then Lazio is sixth place exactly with 45 points. So
that's it.
You know, they can't catch them. Lazio can't catch Inter with this game alone. But if you're going to go from an 8-point deficit to 5 with a win, that's the big. If Inter wins, if Lazio loses this game, just take them out of the Champions League.
Well, I mean, that's what I'm saying. Like, as an individual, like team performance, I guess wise, it's crucial this game. I mean, they need to get all the points they can get. I mean, I don't think they'll be totally devastated with a tie, but they really need all 3 points. And you know what? For Champions League, Europa League, just that middle of the pack race, as we said time and time again on this show, it's heating up, and I think it'll continue heating up all the way to the end of the season.
And then, Sampdoria Milan. You said it. So Milan's at 51 points.
It's important, that one,
for fourth place.
Yeah.
Sampdoria, 42. So, you know, Sampdoria is not trying to chase Milan, but they're trying to chase Lazio, who's 3 points ahead.
No, they want Europe, so.
But, Johnny, you think this is one of the most important games for Sampdoria?
Definitely. They're on the rise. They've been motivated ever since the beginning of the season. As you saw, like, their first win versus Napoli, how they just want to be a different team this season than they have in previous seasons. And I feel like as if overall they've been playing with a chip on their shoulder. So, but you know what? Honestly, though, like, it can't discredit AC Milan. I always say time and time again, I'm a big fan of Gattuso's management style. He's the guy's a very underrated manager. And I think and AC Milan itself is not a team to scoff at. So I actually think it's going to be an offensive game, but I actually think it's going to be like as a 2-2 draw.
I think the one game we're all going to watch, Chievo Cagliari, Friday 3:30. Well, that's actually an important game for the relegation battle. I mean, Chievo is pretty much out of it. Fiorentina Torino, that could be a good game, that actually. I think they're 5 points apart. About 7. They're 7 points apart. Torino, again, they're pushing for the Europa League spot. Fiorentina, again, if they lose this, it's going to be tough for them to catch up.
It is going to be tough. And you know what? We're going on to match day 29. You know, this is the last stretch of the season.
Yeah, less than 10 games left.
10 games left. So it's really going to come down to these last 10 games, and it's going to be crucial. Every point counts. Every win, obviously, is even an added bonus. I agree with you on Fiorentina. We've been praising them quite a bit, I think, on this show, I would say. In the past couple of weeks, they've kind of disappointed a bit. Now that, I don't know, Chiesa has a bit of a knock, I don't know if that's going to affect them going on for the rest of the season. I'm not too sure. I haven't heard anything on that. But if that is the case, it's a pretty big dent.
They also only have one win in the last 5.
That's what I'm
saying. Winless in the last 4.
That's what I'm saying. So these past couple of weeks, it hasn't been their strongest part of the season. And this is when you need to pick up the points, especially in the position that they're in. They're in what? 10th place, I think. So 10th place, and they're at what? 37 points. So they really need a push.
So that'll pretty much do it for us. Adriano, by the way.
Yes.
Milan is the second hottest team right now. Second best informed team.
Yeah. They're also the youngest in the top 5 European leagues.
Yeah, they have 4 wins in their past 5. So does Juve.
Yeah.
No other team, at least in Serie A, has that. Mm-hmm. And interesting stat coming in from Alexander. We have Fiorentina leads the league in counterattack goals. Yeah, that's correct. Leads the league in counterattack goals. So
that's
why their defense needs to do better.